Today's edition of MacVoices is sponsored by Smile, the makers of PDF Pen for Mac, PDF Pen Pro for Mac, PDF Pen for iPhone and iPad, PDF Pen Scan Plus for iPhone and iPad, Text Expander for Mac, and Text Expander for iPhone and iPad. Find out more about all their great products at smilesoftware.com. Welcome to Mac Notables on MacVoices. This is the talk of the Mac community. I'm Chuck Joyner. Folks, we get to have one of our favorite kind of shows this time around. With us, Mr. Adam Engst. Adam, it's good to have you as always.
Nice to be here, Chuck. Thank you.
And Tonya hopefully will join us in a little while. But most important, Adam, we get to go to a party.
Yeah. I mean, this is the best way to do it. None of this just kind of sitting home in our office. Wait, no, we are home in our office. Yeah. But still.
And it's a 25th anniversary party. We have the 25th anniversary of the Southern California Macintosh Users Group. SMOG, it's great to see you. Yeah. Congrats on 25 years. That's phenomenal. So they've asked us, Adam, to come and talk a little bit about essential iOS apps, which is always a fun topic simply because we just have to look at our iPads or iPhones and figure out what we use, right?
Absolutely. And it's not like there's that many to choose from. So, you know, what, just like 25 million, 100 million? I don't know.
Yeah. Just sit there and page and page and page, and by that time the meeting won't be over.
This one looks good.
So I think the place to start would be, what is the first app you install on a new iOS device?
Ooh, that's an interesting question. It's actually almost a hard question because I almost never set up a new iOS device from scratch. Usually it's just, you know, you restore from backup from whatever the last one was and everything comes over. That said, every now and then it is useful for troubleshooting reasons. I actually just had some people complaining about Spotlight not working and the solution to Spotlight just not working. Set the device up from scratch. Annoying, but you got to do it. But so probably the thing that I set up, I'd copy on first. I think that would be the Google app. You know, the general Google search app, because that's what, you know, that is probably my go-to app for. I use the iPhone to answer questions. That is probably my big use for it. And I like the Google app because I want to search in Google. I don't like searching in Bing. And I like doing voice searching, and Siri doesn't work for me as well as Google's voice search. So that's my big one.
That's interesting. I'm like you. A lot of times I just copy over and, you know, keep on moving. But recently when I set up my iPad Pro, I really had to think about this. The first app I put on was Dropbox, simply because there's so many preference files and all that gets synced through that before I set up anything and maybe get things confused, I want Dropbox syncing all of those files into my device. And then when the new app goes and sets itself up, it's like, oh, there's a preference file. Perfect.
Right. Using Text Expander or various apps like that. I certainly use Dropbox. It's on my home screen. I don't tend to rely on it that much for sort of everyday things. And I'm actually honestly not sure what apps might use it for their preferences. Where I really like Dropbox is I'm out and about and I need access to a file. You know, I don't know. I'm not anticipating this. I don't know what I'm going to need. I don't know what I'm going to do. But because so much of what Take Control does is in Dropbox, pretty much everything, in fact, I can get to every book. I can get to every in-progress manuscript, things like that if I have to. And again, not very often, but, you know, I get a call while I'm out and someone needs a file that, you know, for some reason or another, and I can get into Dropbox and send it to them. Same with Google Drive, actually, that I use the Google Drive app for roughly the same kind of thing. It's just different populations use different ones, and different files are in different places.
Yeah, that's interesting. I have not played with Google Drive. I've worked a little bit with the iCloud options of storing some of your preferences and files there, and that's fine for the Apple apps, but I just still don't quite have that comfort level. And
I have to admit, I don't use iCloud basically at all, but there is a tip for people here. There is an iCloud Drive app, and you don't get it from the App Store. I have to look at this because it's not something I know offhand. You get it from Settings, iCloud Drive, And then there is a show on home screen setting. Yeah, settings, iCloud, iCloud Drive, show on home screen. That's how you get the iCloud Drive app. If anyone is using iCloud and wants to be able to browse the files in it as though they were, you know, in a Finder or something.
I did not know about that. Thank you. Okay. Now I've got a tip, folks. That's the way to, that's the way to do it. That's the way to do it. Okay, so you use Google. And I have pretty good luck with Siri. I also, though, the nice thing about Google is it seems to have a bit more, you can do a little bit more with it as far as, like you said, searching, as opposed to just having commands responded to by Siri.
Yeah. The other thing that I find about Google, and this is just a little bit of a frustration, is that Siri, of course, dumps you into Safari. And Safari is a fine web browser. But I hate searching in Safari, partly because you got to tap in the really tiny box at the top. It's just one of those things. When I go into Google, you know, you get... I've got to clear it because I'm in the middle of things. You know, you just get this nice, nice big button for doing a voice search, and a big. You can't even really see it. Maybe you can see it. And a nice big search field. The iPhone is a small screen, and having things be small targets on a small screen isn't as good usability. And so that's something I think Apple really could do better. Instead of having Safari, at least as an option, instead of having Safari show you, you know, the little thumbnails for all the things you've seen before, wouldn't it be nice if we had just a really big search field? Because that's what you're going to want to do a whole lot of the time.
Yeah, yeah. Have you tried the Hound yet? The new?
I have not. I downloaded it, but I haven't tried it.
Yeah.
So just for folks' reference, you know, when Chuck and I were talking about, you know, what are our favorite apps, I started paging through all the screens and screens and screens and screens of apps that I have, because in my position, I have to try all sorts of things. Something interesting comes out, sure, I'll download that app. My iPhone is an absolute disaster as far as finding anything after the first screen. Frankly, I don't. I use Spotlight. Here's a good example. In Ithaca, both Cornell and downtown Ithaca now have parking that is done via an app called Parkmobile. And this is great. I'm so glad they use the same app. And it's a fine little app, but I don't need to park very often. I mean, you know, once every two, three weeks, month, something like that. And so I don't want this app on my home screen, and I haven't the foggiest idea where it is. I literally no idea where in the home screen, you know, the 6 or 7 or 8 home screens of apps I have. So that's something that I use Spotlight for to pull up just about every time. Or same thing like Google Authenticator and Authy, you know, tools for two-factor authentication. Just don't need them that often. So they get dumped off somewhere.
I don't want to take us too far off the essential apps track, but I've got to ask you about that, because we just had this discussion the other night at my user group. Do you bother to organize things into folders, or do you just have a tendency to do like I do, just leave them where they are and then use Spotlight to find them?
Yeah, no, I have one folder for Apple apps. The Apple apps folder, because there's a whole lot of Apple apps that I don't actually use that much, but of course I want to have access to them, and that's a way that I think about them. I think about them all coming from Apple. So, you know, Airport Utility, Calendar, Contacts, Find My iPhone, Find My Friends, just lumps all those together and at one place and where I think to find them. That is a...
Interesting approach. Nobody has suggested that particular approach. One friend that showed us his app, he just has one screen, of course, of apps, but it's all folders, and then he has to dig down sometimes two layers, and it's like, I'm missing the point. I mean, okay, we're all a little ADD, let's face it, but not quite that bad.
What I would like to train myself, and this is one of the interesting things for people to think about as you get more and more apps, is that you can get Siri to open a lot of these things, and I just haven't actually trained myself to do that. With Siri, you have to really sit down and say, you know, open Parkmobile, open Parkmobile, open Parkmobile a few times until watching my iPhone do something if I'm careful, until it actually gets lodged in your brain appropriately. So I'm really good. For instance, I use the Apple Watch for, you know, like setting reminders and texting Tristan to come down for dinner and stuff like that. but those I've built those into my way of working. So any of that, but we're getting off track too much. Let's go back and look some more apps.
Yeah, I'm going to just add to that because my iPhone at night lives on a stand beside my bed, and so as I'm getting ready for bed, I'm usually going through, like you say, kind of a ritual of Siri commands to set an alarm, to launch a particular app for, you know, for nighttime, to do a number of things like that. So it's something not to be overlooked.
And that is a perfect segue because one of the apps on my dock, because I use it absolutely every night, is an Apple app. It's not a very good app. In fact, it's a really pretty bad app. It provides access to is absolutely essential. iTunes U.
Oh.
So the iTunes U app, Tonya and I listen to mostly lectures. Yale actually does the best ones, unfortunately. We're a little sad about the Cornell doesn't, but we listen to lectures for 15 minutes to go to sleep every night. And this, we've been doing this for over a decade, and it is just brilliant because you find a class, it's about a topic that you're kind of interested in, you know, but, you know, the professor might go on a little bit, you know, it needs to be a lecture and all that, and you fall asleep, and that's okay. Because you're not taking it for credit. And we'll sometimes go through these classes a couple of times. I mean, you know, it sinks in eventually. So we've done sports physiology, we've done nutrition, psychology, ancient Greek history. It's fabulous. We've learned way more about the Civil War and the American Revolution than we ever thought we would.
So is there
particular, but it takes a while.
Is there a particular professor that – no, never mind. We don't want to – the professor
I'm just saying Yale is good.
And now we've been joined by Mrs. Adam Engst, Tonya Engst. Tonya, it's great to have you. Thanks for being here and being part of the 25th anniversary celebration.
Hi, everyone. It is really neat to be here. And my son, Tristan, and I was doing not soccer momming, but fencing momming. He was really good about leaving his fencing lesson as soon as he possibly could. So I'm only a little late.
Tonya, we'll let you play catch up for just a second. I ask Adam to start us out with the what is the first app that you install on a brand new iOS device?
Oh, do you want me to answer that right now?
Sure, yeah. Adam and I already did, so it's your turn.
On the spot.
It's a toss-up. The first app is either 1Password, because 1Password knows all my passwords, and it's pretty much impossible to install any other app if you don't have your passwords. Or my first app is Dropbox, because I store a lot of stuff in Dropbox, and I also use Dropbox to send screenshots from my iPhone to my Mac. And that's a somewhat uncommon use for the iPhone, but if you're a technology writer, you need to start sending your screenshots to your Mac pretty quickly so you can put them in whatever you're working on. But I just adore 1Password, because when you get it fully set up, you can enter passwords just by touching the Touch ID button on your iPhone, and that's just completely miraculous and amazing.
And Tonya has a 6S, so Touch ID is even faster and better than on my 6.
And it's interesting, Tonya. I said Dropbox was my number one, but actually I never did get to follow up on it. And that's one of the reasons, because 1Password syncs into that, and you're right. Then 1Password is my next one, so that I have the passwords, and from there it's just whatever I feel like. So good choices. Yeah. Good choices.
Sorry, I actually can never remember, because I have to keep testing for the Take Control books. I'm not even sure I can tell you at this point in time whether my 1Password syncs through Dropbox, at which point it would make sense to install Dropbox first, or if it syncs through iCloud, because I sometimes have to change it around to test stuff, and I'm not sure where we're at right now.
Okay. So let's see, I guess where were we? We were just getting back to cool apps. We had talked about Siri a little bit, some of the voice control stuff. Adam, give me another favorite app and why.
Well, I'm pretty fond of Fantastical, which is a calendar replacement from Flexibits. And, you know, it's sort of hard to say why, but the simple fact is it's just a better app. That it does calendaring in a faster, more fluid way that makes it easier to see what's coming up. I particularly like the fact that when you launch, when it, sort of its standard view, you get about the top, you know, third of the screen is a standard kind of month calendar. And then below that is just a scrolling list of everything that happened, everything that's sort of visible in the days around where you are. And you can scroll, you know, you can scroll in the top calendar view or in the bottom list. And it's a really great way to just sort of go, what's coming up? You know, what are we doing this week? And you can see, because it's just this list of events, you can, and then you can see each day that they pop up on. So so that's probably my, you know, another one of my preferred Apple app replacements.
Okay. Tonya, calendaring app. You Fantastical as well?
Well, I was saying to you, Chuck, yesterday in email that honestly, I tend to kind of stick to the Apple apps. And that's not because I'm, you know, incapable or uncurious, but because it's so important for me to be really fluid with them and really quick to identify differences between, you know, what's going on in a certain version of the operating system, that it's just become too impossible to keep up with everything Apple is doing and install other stuff. So on my iPhone, I use the Calendars app, and, you know, for what I need to do, it does get the job done, and that's good enough for me. And I love it when I'm at the doctor's office and, you know, they say, oh, when do you want your next appointment? And I pull up my phone and I can look right there and I can put it in right there and it's done. And, you know, it does sync to Adam's calendaring system and to my son's calendaring system. So we can all see when, who has what dentist appointment. And I am satisfied. It's not perfect, but I'm satisfied. And when Apple rolls out another version of iOS next fall, I will have to learn the new one if there are any changes. And it's just enough for my brain to stick with what Apple's doing.
That's interesting. I prefer Calendars 5 from Readdle for one very simple reason. I maintain my own personal calendars through Apple's calendaring system, but we use a Google calendar system at work. And Calendars 5 is the only thing that I've been able to find that syncs reliably, consistently, accurately. Now, I know that, and it's been a while since I've really done any research, but for a while it was just really difficult because sometimes some things would appear and some things wouldn't, and it was just a disaster. And Calendars 5 solved the problem. So for now, that's where I'm sticking.
Yeah, well, and Readdle is a great company, and they make very nice apps, yeah. Definitely.
So this is sort of just an interesting larger perspective, too, which is one of the things that we were talking about, Google Drive and Dropbox, you know, calendars with each other, iCloud calendars and Google calendars. And sometimes you just, to intersect with the larger world, you need to have apps that look beyond what Apple will give you. And so a lot of the Google solutions are more heavily used by people who use Windows and Android. And if they're the people in your nonprofit organization or your club or whatever, you end up avoiding iCloud stuff just because it's not universal enough. So that's one of the reasons why we look to these other apps.
Yeah. Since we're on sort of the typical productivity apps, how about, how about contacts? Are you just using the regular contact manager or anything different?
We're kind of suffering with the fact that we don't have our contacts merged. I think that's safe to say. Because the Christmas card list gets more and more challenging.
It's a disaster. It's a disaster, honestly. And the whole thing's even made even worse by the fact that I have multiple iCloud accounts, multiple Apple IDs, because of the way Apple did things. And for reasons that were logical at one point in time, 3-5 years ago, whatever it was, my aceatibbets.com account, which is sort of like the big one that I use for everything, was not what I used for calendars and contacts and whatnot in iCloud. And so I'm still kind of trying to wrest control of all my data back from that other iCloud account.
And then there's my mom. Who uses contacts, and she got into just sort of kerfluffle with it because on your iPhone and your Mac now, you can get into the settings and the system preferences, and you can turn on Facebook contacts. and that brings a Facebook group into contacts and shows you all the contact information of all your Facebook friends. And she just was having a lot of trouble understanding how the data got in and how to turn it on and how to turn it off. And we sat down for a while and sorted it.
Yeah, I dread those things that either want to access my contacts or worse, manage my contacts, because I suddenly end up with people that honestly, I love you, but I don't know who you are. So, you know, why are you in my contacts?
Well, the good news is if you don't want your Facebook friends in contacts, you can just go in and uncheck the checkbox and poof, they go away. The problem for my mom is they all go away. And she wanted a couple of pieces of data from that. So she had to spend a little time to sort that out.
One of the reasons also why I think we don't use special apps is that the Contacts app is not something you really use in iOS much anymore, that Apple really pushes you more towards accessing the contacts from the appropriate app. So phone, for instance, you know, that you can get into all the stuff from contacts that you would in the phone app. So that's not a big one. And of course, when you do spotlight searches or Siri searches, you can get all of that, all of the contact information there too. So I think that that's been a place where that's just become kind of low level system data rather than something you interact with on a big way.
All right. So I'm going to take us to one more productivity app, and then we'll go back to some fun stuff. But how about to-do lists? Do you manage your to-do lists on your iOS devices? And if you do, what are your apps? Uh-oh. I don't like those. Both of them chuckled, folks. I don't know if this is good. Tonya? Okay, a piece of paper just got an applause. I don't know what to make of that.
It's an essential iOS app, piece of paper.
Yeah.
I use reminders because I have the Apple Watch, so I can just say to it, make a reminder to look at this again at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning, and that will show up on my calendar, which I will look at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. So I do have some integration there, but I just find that the piece of paper, it is with me at all times. It's a physical thing. I can't. And it works for me. I'm just not modern enough, I guess.
So let's see. Tonya's Apple Watch integrates with a piece of paper. Okay.
And I'll let Adam, who is probably going to talk about Trello. I use Trello.
I find the whole field of to-do apps and whatnot to be utterly inscrutable. There's so many of them, and they all promise to fix your life. And I've tried hundreds of them over time, and realistically, I'm actually relatively similar to Tonya in the sense that I use the Reminders app via the Apple Watch a lot. But that's really for I need to remember to do this thing tomorrow afternoon, or make sure I don't I'm downtown shopping. I know I'll be downtown, so remind me to return the library book while I'm doing that. That's not really to-do items. What I've found, somewhat sadly, for some of these philosophies, is that I like to have to-do items in my head. That if I write them down, it's the kiss of death, and they don't get done. And so, I have this constant like, what do I need to do next? What do I do next? And I'm thinking about the thing as well. So it's not just a remembering I need to do it. It's the and what am I going to write when I write that article that I need to write. So, all that said, we have a system we use called Trello. It's a free internet service, and there's a pretty good app for iPhone and iPad, as well as you can use it in web browsers on the Mac. And Trello is absolutely brilliant for collaborative to-dos. So when we have a book, for instance, we don't actually even use it so much for to-dos. And Tonya does a little bit on some of her bigger planning stuff, but for process lists. So we're putting out a book. Do you know how many tasks are involved with putting out a book?
Hang on a second. I'm going to show everybody from Trello. I hope this is big enough. This is a list of books that we're working on right now in Trello. And each one has its own little card. Can people see that?
Little circles are the people involved with that card, okay. Which are me and Tonya and the author and the editor. And so it's a way to bring all that information together and to have those tasks associated with a thing. and to be able to talk about them, mark them as done, say, Tonya can leave a note for me saying, hey, we need a cover for this book. I can check off the, you know, the cover thing, and I made an ISBN for it, and I can tell her back again,
here's a checklist for a book.
So Trello is great for that. But honestly, again, I don't use it for smaller stuff or for personal stuff. As I said, Tonya does more sort of big picture planning than I do.
What's really great in Trello is you can get into a list of things that need to get done for a book. And then you can send a little email right from the Trello card to someone saying, you know, hey, could you complete this little task? And then they get the email and then they do it. It's good.
What's the learning curve on Trello?
Oh, Trello's easy.
It's really easy to get started with, and it's really fun. It's very visual.
Okay, here's the very short overview of Trello. Imagine you have a whiteboard. Imagine you take a marker and you draw columns on the whiteboard. So you've got lists, these column lists. And then imagine you have post-it notes, and you can put the post-it notes anywhere you want in any one of those columns. A post-it note is like a card in Trello, so we have a card for a book. And then the lists can be anything you want. So we have lists that are like, talking about, editing, in production, finished, you know, and we actually take the post-it note and move it from list to list to list, so you can see where it is. And then those post-it notes, unlike real live post-it notes, can have all sorts of cool stuff attached to them. They can have checklists and conversations and even files attached to them.
So most of our boards go from ideas at the left to completion on the right. So the left-hand board for the Take Control books is book ideas that either we've had or other people have suggested. There's probably like 50 books in this list, just ideas. And so when we're trying to think of, well, you know, like, what book should we do? What do we want to work on that we haven't really been talking about? We're not like digging an email or trying to remember what some guy said. We really do a good job of putting it all in that list. It's very helpful for us. And we put everyone's email addresses in, so if we ever do the book, we can email them. We're actually very proud of ourselves for keeping track of it.
And just to be clear, you know, when I said, you know, sort of whiteboard, lists, and cards, all of those are just what you want them to be. Unlike so many of these systems, these to-do systems, they're like, and you will have projects, and you will have to-dasks, and you will have, you know, deadlines. And they want you to fit what you do into their funnel, whereas Trello is great about saying, you got these blank spaces, you got these cards, you got these lists, you title them, you say what they mean.
My dad used Trello. My parents are retired, and they're doing a really good job with it, and they're doing a lot of travel. So when they do longer trips, my dad has been using Trello where, for the most part, each day gets a column. And then he starts slotting into the day like, okay, this day we're going to go to this museum, and this day, you know, we're going to eat dinner here, and this day we're traveling on this plane. And he gets all the different activities that they're going to do onto the different days. And then he can share that board with me so I know where they're going. But he uses the board to plan it.
And then if something changes, it's easy to just say, well, I guess we're not going to go to that museum this day. Let's just drag it to this other column and put it on the day before or the day after, something like that. So brilliant system. It's free. I recommend everyone try it. It's just nice because you make of it what you want to.
Yeah, I don't think I ever understood it, that it could be used as a to-do list. I understood it as a bit of a more of a project management system, but the way you described it now makes me want to go and take another look.
And of course, you wouldn't use it primarily on the iPhone unless the iPhone was the only computer that you had, because you can use it on the web and you can blow it up to the full size of a big monitor. You can use it on an iPad too, but the point is we install it on the iPhone because we like to look at it there too. But I wouldn't get started on the iPhone because I think it'd be easier to work with in a bigger environment.
You really gotta think of it as a whiteboard. You know, and the iPhone is only showing you one column at a time. So the iPad is actually pretty good, though.
Good. Okay. All right. So let's step away from productivity apps and let's talk about fun apps. And fun is defined as however you want to define it as fun.
We have fun, too?
Yeah, well.
Man, I got to think about that.
Well, our idea of fun may not be the same as their idea of fun.
Strava!
Wait, that's what I was going to say.
Okay, you can say Strava.
No, you can say Strava.
Can you tell they're married, folks?
We both use Strava.
Okay, what is Strava? I don't
know. We're friends on Strava.
What your friends on Strava? All right, Adam, what's Strava?
Strava is a social workout log. And so when you use something like a Garmin 620, or Tonya has a Garmin VivoFit GPS watch, you can upload all your workouts to Strava, and they show up, and all your friends on Strava can see what you've done. And they can, give you a kudos or make a comment or whatnot. And this is actually kind of appropriate because, I mean, like, a lot of people who are my friends in real life, or even on Facebook, I don't necessarily want to talk to them about the random things that they're thinking about or posting or whatnot. But my running friends and my biking friends, I actually do want to talk to them about what they're running and what they're biking. If they ran a race, or I can at a glance, look at a friend and say, "Wow, that's a great workout. that was really impressive." Or you see someone who's coming back from an injury, and you can, be supportive or things like that. So it contextualizes a lot of the social stuff. And it's a really nice way to see, what your weekly mileage is and track your how many miles you have in your shoes, or how far you biked last year, that kind of stuff.
Wait a minute. How many miles you have on your shoes?
Well, you don't last forever.
I mean, You're supposed to replace your running shoes after a certain number of miles, or it's just something to think about after a while, because, the cushioning breaks down.
500 miles.
Okay. I never thought of it, though. I change the tires on my car when the treads wear down. But
it's very similar. Okay. It's very similar. But see, the problem is the materials are so good now that shoes can wear out without actually looking bad sometimes. And so then you can actually get injured because you're wearing shoes that they're off balance, or the cushioning's been damaged or whatever. So, I mean, admittedly, I think some of that's overblown too, but really after 500 miles, you should start thinking about the next pair.
Okay, good to know. Folks, how many?
There's sort of a song there, like, if you miss the train I'm on, I've been running 500 miles.
Okay.
Anyway.
So in our audience, how many people have put 500 miles on their shoes? Yeah, that's what I thought.
You guys got to start doing walking meetings.
You're not tracking it. That's the problem. I guarantee you have. You'd be surprised how fast those miles add up.
Okay. Tonya, I let Adam do the Strava thing. Give me what you consider a fun app.
Well, for a while, I was using Words with Friends, which lets you do these little word games where you either are competing with people who you know, or if none of the people who you know are available, you can even compete with strangers. And I found it very fun, possibly too fun, sort of addictive, and I had to stop. And I had to take the thing off my phone.
Okay, that's fair. I'm going to throw one in, and it'll probably take us in another direction, but I've spend a lot of time listening to podcasts. Any free time I have usually goes in that direction. That or music, of course. And I prefer Downcast as a podcatcher, simply because it has so many controls. If you boot it up for the first time or launch it for the first time, depending on whether you get the Mac or iOS version, and they do have compatible versions at sync, it might be a little daunting simply because there are so many options. But I love the fine-grained control that I can do pretty much anything I want with an individual podcast. I can have it refresh when I want. I can have all kind of settings. I can have it play at a particular speed. I can even skip the inevitable intro that all of us podcasters put on things if I don't want to hear it anymore. Just go right to,
Trick, yes.
Yeah, the first 30 seconds, I don't need to hear the intro. I just want to get to the meat of the show. So it's really a great one. And again, it's available for everything. And the other one, the other big dog in the room seems to be Overcast. But Overcast does not do video podcasts. And that makes me crazy. So that Downcast handles both audio and video. And that's why I love it.
I used to use Downcast, and now I'm using Overcast, but I have much, much, much less in the way of needs as you do.
Let me say something to support most fully what Chuck has said, but also to have a contrarian point of view, which is that I use the podcast app, which is Apple's app, and I mostly use it so that when we're writing about it in our different books, I know whether it's okay to say something like, you should never use this app because it's just terrible, or many people find that they enjoy third-party apps, which is a sort of more neutral way of putting it. But I feel really uncomfortable saying that an app is just terrible, you know, unless I really feel that I can support it. So I kind of, you know, I live it. But I do know its quirks. It's really quite poor, although Apple does keep trying.
Yeah, I tend to agree with that. And I just abandoned it a long time ago. It was too much work trying to keep up with things that, unfortunately, they didn't function the way they were supposed to or that you expected them to. And that's no fun at all.
Well, one of the best things about listening to podcasts, in my experience, and this should work with any podcasting app, is especially if you're in the car and you're listening to one, you can pause it and replay it from your wrist. That is so cool. I love it.
Yes. Yes. Downcast will let you do that too.
I'm sure. Yeah. It's just kind of whatever is playing. But it's just one of those like modern, like who would have thought 10 years ago, who would have thought when I was a kid, like just how cool is that? You know, you can practically do it without even taking your eyes off the road.
Yeah. One other thing too about Downcast, and Adam, I want to borrow something you said about the Google app. When you're playing a podcast, you can put your phone wherever it is in the car, and okay, you want to pause it or you need to pause it for some reason, you reach over and you can just tap the whole screen. You don't have to hit a particular button. It's just the whole screen is your pause and play button. And I think
that is
that's
a great feature.
That's brilliant, especially when you're using it in the car.
Yeah. Well, in terms of this topic, however, I have a couple of others. NPR One, I've actually gotten quite fond of. I do a fair amount of physical therapy for various running-related reasons, and it's not long enough that I necessarily want to start a podcast. You know, if I'm only doing something for 5 minutes, I don't like listening to podcasts in small chunks. I like listening to them, you know, so I can at least get halfway through or the whole way through of a reasonable length podcast. And so NPR has just done a really nice job with this app that you can. It will always give you the latest news, although you can skip it if you don't want to listen to the news because the news is, well, tiring. And after that, as you use the app more, you can just tap an interesting button when you think you listen to a segment that you thought was particularly good, and it will try to play more like that. And it does a pretty decent job. So, you know, again, it's one of those things where it's not just like turning on the radio, but it's like turning on the radio when they're playing more of the things that you actually want to hear.
Okay, I'm not that big an NPR listener, but that's interesting that they have adapted the artificial intelligence to find you other things that you might like.
And they produce such a lot of content and actually have such a back catalog that they can actually really do that. Because, I mean, one of the things that you also run into in sort of the modern world is that there's lots of great stuff that happened a month ago, 6 months ago, a year ago, that you just may have missed. And, you know, I have no idea how much, you know, content they produce on a daily or weekly basis, but it's insanely large. And, you know, when you go back across time, they can really pull stuff out for you.
Okay. I'm just looking at my list of things. I'm really curious, do you all do any writing? I know, Tonya, you're talking about the project management. Do you do any writing on your phones or your iPads?
Voice dictation.
Okay.
But not for real writing.
Not for writing.
I mean, no.
Okay, well, I'll take that. Do you have any particular apps or do you just rely on what Apple has built in for dictation?
Oh, most of my writing on the iPhone is text messaging.
Oh.
Okay. Yeah, no, we don't.
I really don't try to compose text.
I mean, I know some people do it. I honestly, as a professional writer, cannot understand it. I cannot understand how anyone can write effectively on particularly a phone, you know, iPad a little bit more so. But, I mean, the Mac is such a serious writing tool when you have a big screen and a powerful word processor. And I just can't imagine why you would settle for something that's much, much worse. And every app that I've seen is much, much worse.
Hmm. Because I've used drafts quite a bit, and especially using the dictation with drafts, just to get something in. You know, it's not supposed to be polished by any means, but just, you know, the idea, okay, I have a random thought, I want to get it down in some kind of coherent message, and there's Tonya breaking out the paper again. Yeah.
I was going to say, perhaps as a professional writer, I don't write drafts.
Final.
It's no help to me at all to, I mean, obviously I edit, I go back and edit what I write, but I don't write a draft and then think, oh, that wasn't very good, and go back and rewrite it or something like that. I write from the beginning to the end, and then I go back and edit what I wrote. So, but I've been writing for 26 years professionally. So, you know, it may be different for me, but it's just, you know, iOS devices simply don't work for any of that kind of functionality. I mean, the main thing I use the iPad for is watching Netflix. I use the iPhone all the time. The iPad, I forget about it for days or weeks on end.
Adam, how long did you say you've been writing?
Well, we've been publishing tidbits for 26 years come April. So
okay, so you started 1 year before SMOG. That's impressive. That's impressive.
So it's been a long time, and you know, and as I said, when you're publishing for, you know, weekly newsletter, and then, you know, we've written books and things like that. You know, I just spend all day, and Tonya does this too. I mean, when in editing more so than writing, you know, I just do so much editing and writing that I need to be as fast and fluid as possible at that, and that's partly technique and it's partly tools, and I'm just not willing to take anything that slows me down.
One more category, and then I want to make sure because I'm not quite sure how we're doing on time. How do we stand, folks? Okay, we're good. One more category.
We've been talking about this for a long time. Yeah, be careful.
Yeah. Well, one more category, and then we'll let folks ask some questions, or we'll just keep on rolling. How about social media apps? Do you have preferred? I don't know where you all consider yourselves active on Facebook, Twitter, anywhere else.
Go ahead, Tonya.
I use the built-in apps.
Well, Twitter app, the Facebook app.
Well, I mean, so on the one hand, there's Facebook, which is really where I do a lot of communicating with relatives and friends, and then there's Twitter, which isn't what it used to be, but it's more where I would talk about work or Mac type stuff. And then recently over here in the Tidbits world, we've been exploring Slack, which is a very up and coming kind of social networking tool where you're networking within a team.
A group messaging tool.
And we're actually doing a book right now with Glenn Fleischman about Slack. And there are some articles that have just been posted to the Tidbits website that will become chapters of the book. So if someone wants to learn more about Slack afterwards, they can go check it out. And Slack is meant to be for getting things done and in focused conversations, but it's also meant to be fun. So there's a lot of little fun quirks to it. And I think Adam wants to say more about Slack.
Yeah. Well, I was just going to say
body language.
The social networking stuff. I mean, this is true for both of us to an extent. We've just gotten so tired of it. It's all consuming. It could take all of your possible time, and so much of what's there is like, hey, look at this cool article. Look at this cool article. I don't want to look at the cool article. I have to get my work done. And so, you know, I tend to actually use Google Plus. I have an app for it on my phone. I use it occasionally. And then the only reason why I use Google Plus is because there's another service called Friends Plus Me, which will cross-post from Google Plus to Twitter and Facebook. And so I treat them all in sort of write-only mode. If I'm going to say, hey, this is an interesting thing or whatever, that's what how I'll do that. And I'll reply to anyone who wants to have a conversation, but I do not seek out conversations online in the social media space. That said, as Tonya said, Slack has become a really big deal for us because it's our groups. It's the, you know, it's the Tidbits and the Take Control authors. And those are the people who I'm most interested in interacting with. And it's more messaging. So it's more like a chat in messages than Twitter or Facebook, where it's really hard to have a conversation of any real depth or interest. So Slack is very cool stuff. I could imagine, for instance, SMOG having its own Slack team for everyone in the group to get together, pop in, ask a question. If people are online, they can answer it. If they come online later, they can see the question and answer it, that kind of thing. So possibility for the user group to look into.
Adam, does it feel like those kind of that is just revisiting the old message boards and Facebook
Slack
groups?
Slack is just IRC.
Completely revisiting the old message boards. But, it's been, with a couple decades of experience on what you might want them to be like, and they're modern. Feels modern.
So Slack is like IRC, Internet Relay Chat, on steroids, brought into the modern world. And the very, very cool thing they do is they make it so that other services, Trello,
Dropbox,
Google Drive, Gmail, almost anything you can think of, can talk with Slack or talk into Slack. So for instance, on our Trello boards, we have a board that tracks Tibbetts articles, what status they're in and whatnot. And I have Trello notifying a Slack channel when those things happen. Mm. And so, in Slack, I can just see, boom, this happened, boom, this happened, boom, this happened, and be able to keep an eye on what's going on without having to be constantly checking my, checking what's going on in email or watching Trello directly. So it's a way to kind of funnel a whole lot of stuff into one bucket where you can actually see what's going on really well.
Interesting.
So, but it's a big thing and something people need to you have to adopt it for a group. It's not something you just kind of wander around.
I think that if a person has used Twitter or is using Facebook, it's probably sort of worth being aware of Slack, because I think that some of the warmth and some of the more personal connections that might have otherwise happened on those networks are actually moving into Slack, which is a more private environment. But it also may mean that, if you were enjoying certain people on Twitter, those people, their boss or the group that they're in may have said, we're all doing this over in Slack now. So they may sort of be moving away from those broad social networking environments. And so I think that could explain why those environments are, I think they're coming a little bit more boring and impersonal. I think that's partly why when we started to learn more about Slack, I found out that some of the other publications that a lot of my colleagues work on had made internal Slack boards, because they're internal. Well, I'm not on them because I don't, work for the wire cutter or whatever it is. But apparently all kinds of great stuff goes on there, which I'm not party to. And I think, 5 years ago, more of that would have happened on Twitter, for instance.
I think I really prefer Twitter as my social network of choice, but I think you have to be careful with it and manage it. If you just start following people randomly, or if there's someone that just fills your Twitter feed with junk or non-relevant stuff, I might like them, but I've got to take them off because it takes away from it as being a useful tool for me. So I think you have to manage it carefully, or it turns into noise.
Yeah, we shouldn't go down this too far much further, but I do want to say that, you can think of Twitter and Facebook as publishing. When people are posting there, they're publishing. In something like Slack, you're conversing. You're not publishing. Simple as that.
All right. Good example. So if you want to know more about Slack, check out Glenn's stuff on Tidbits right now. Let's go to some questions from the audience, if there are any, because again, I've still got a long list that we haven't started on. But what do you all want to hear from us, or what are you interested in? What apps are you looking at? And we'll probably have to have someone translate for us because we can't really hear you.
They're asking about your favorite notes app, like Evernote or OneNote or Notability or the new Apple Notes app.
Great. Tonya, how about we start with you?
Well, For a long time, I used Notebook from Circus Pony Software, and I started using it a little arbitrarily, and at some point I thought, well, you know, is this really the best one? There are so many, and I decided to stay with it because I already had a lot of stuff in it, and it worked well enough. I have a lot of trouble with notes. Adam commented that if he wrote something down on a to-do list, it would never get done. And I have a little bit of that kind of trouble with notes. So something like Evernote, one of the things that it does really well is it stores stuff so you can read it later. So I have all kinds of stuff stored to read later, both in Circus Pony Software's notebook and in other things. And as soon as I store something to read later, do you know what happens? Nothing happens.
It's a death.
I have this theory that maybe in 20 years I'll retire and I'll spend a complete year like throwing out stuff that I thought I might read. So having observed that behavior in myself for quite a few years, I've pretty much stopped recording this stuff because it just seems so pointless. But to get more close to the point, Circus Pony Software kind of discontinued Notebook or went out of business or something, can't remember exactly what, not that long ago. So I decided that I would actually transition some of my stuff to Notes, because now that in iOS 9 and El Capitan, Notes is a much more full-featured software than it used to be, that it made sense for me to really know how to use it so that I can write about it and talk about it. So some of my stuff is going there, but some of my stuff, it doesn't really make sense to just have in my own little iCloud account where only I can really work with it, because Adam needs to see it too, because he's in my most sort of immediate work group with work stuff, and he's my husband. And so other stuff has been moving into Google Docs, into shared documents, so that we can both get at that stuff if we need to.
Adam?
Yeah, I don't really do notes. I mean, the problem is that information has to come from somewhere, right? So what would you put in a note? You know, what kind of information would you store in a note? So I talked about using Trello for process lists. That's something that I might store in a note-taking app, because it's something that I'm generating. I'm just like, okay, the steps I need to do to create, you know, a chapter, one of these chapticles for the Slack book or something, are, you know, it's this set of five tasks. And I have to write notes on that, because I don't remember how to do it if it's been 6 months since I did the last one. So for those kinds of things, I'll often use Trello. A lot of other things that people would put in a notes app, I get an email, or maybe I'll see a reference to an article that I should read or something like that. And I will usually try to, if it's an email, it'll be an email and I'll deal with it in email, and I will not try to transfer it out to somewhere else. If it's just something I'm sending to myself, like I come across something that was really interesting, I don't have time to read, I'll actually message it to myself. And because it's, you know, I can use messages really easily to share from something on the iPhone, and then it's on my Mac where I can actually read something, you know, more effectively later on. And so I find that I don't take notes a lot of the time, because a lot of the pieces of information that I would need are already somewhere that I can get to them later if I so wish. So, yeah, so I've tried those things. I have the notes app. Actually, I probably have 4 or 5 pages of notes on various things, but it's like the dimensions of a piece of wood that I need to buy at the hardware store. You know, it's something that I'm recording temporarily for a while. So, you know, yeah, I'll use notes for that, but it's minor.
I have more things to say about notes. I remembered that I keep more notes. I remembered that I keep notes in Trello about people. And so here's my notes about people. So each person has a card, and what I put on their card are two things. One, when they're going on vacation, because every 6 months or every year or so, people do go on vacation. And I put on what we last agreed about what their deadline was. Because this stuff is otherwise in email, but it's too hard to find. You're searching on like Joe, vacation, California, and you get like 500 messages, and you then spend like the next hour like getting rid of messages or answering random email that's clogging your search. So it's hopeless. So I do put them on, do take notes, and that's Trello again, which keeps coming up because it's so versatile. And then the other thing that I actually do when Apple has one of their every quarter or so they have one of their, you know, presentations where you can watch it online if you don't happen to be in California in person. And I actually take notes in a notebook. And the reason why I do that is because in college, back in the old days, I took notes in notebooks there too. And I developed the skill of writing in the notebook without looking at the piece of paper. And I find that that is a more effective way for me to take notes than with a computer. And there's lots of research about that, talking about different note-taking styles and why that may be. But I do it. It's a little blast from the past, but what's really fun about it is I can now pull up notes I took, you know, 4 or 5 years ago with the charts and the circles and the arrows and, you know, the what version of what iPad works with what thing. And it's all there. And I'm not sitting there going, oh my God, what note-taking system did I put this in 5 years ago? Was it when I was testing DevonThink? Maybe it's in DevonThink. Oh wait, maybe that was the stage when I thought I would put it on in the Stickies program. Or, oh my God, that was the stage when I just wrote it all in TextEdit and organized it in folders. Or who knows where I might have put it. I just have the one notebook.
So that is
the rest of my discourse on notes.
So the thing that I think actually, which is perhaps the practical upshot here, is you can take notes in anything. There's a bazillion solutions. The question is, what are those notes going to be used for, and is that actually a useful thing? So, you know, Trello, again, we actually have a Trello board for keeping track of what presents we buy people in our family.
That is true. Because Christmas rolls around every year, and we're like, oh, who did we get the candles for last year?
and so, you know, but so that there's very much, there's a function to those notes, and we've actually used them. I mean, so, you know, I actually, for instance, I never take notes when I'm listening to Apple events. I mean, we're going to write the article.
You can always watch the event again. We watch it on our Apple TV in the living room. So, you know, you can always go back.
But more the point being that I write the article, or, you know, with Michael and Josh, I'll write our coverage. And we'll be looking up all those details. Those details will be in my head at that point. And if they cease to be in my head, they're in the article. You know, later on, I'm not going to go back to random notes I took. I'm going to go back to the polished article where I checked and double-checked and verified absolutely every fact. And so, you know, I've given up when I go to talks. I've given up taking notes because I would have these notes and I would find them a year or two or 3 years later. I wouldn't even remember what they were from. I certainly never used them. So it was one of those things where I was like, okay, I'm only going to make notes when there's a function that these notes are going to serve in the future. And if I don't know what that is, I'm not going to bother to take them. You know, too much to my head.
I find the whole topic of notes fascinating because notes seems to mean something to everyone else. And Adam, your comment about the piece of wood was perfect because I kind of got into Evernote about four and a half years ago now when I bought my house. And I started measuring everything in the house because when you're out, you say, gee, I think that might fit there or this might fit over here. But I got to go home and check that. And if I put it in Evernote, of course, it was syncing between my Mac and all my iOS devices, so I could pull my phone out and say, oh yeah, that table will fit there, or no, that sofa will not fit there. And since then, it's for me, notes, Evernote right now, and I'm looking at moving over to Notes once the next version comes, because allegedly the next version of Apple's Notes will import automatically Evernote.
That'd be nice.
Yeah, it would be very nice. But I use it almost as a filing cabinet for information that, as you said, will be relevant in the future or something I don't want to lose. Because otherwise, I don't know where it is on my hard drive. Searching has definitely gotten better. But Tonya, to your point, searching on Vacation Joe, California, you know, sometimes it doesn't always pop up the way I want it to. So. Yeah.
All right.
Does that answer? Category. Yeah, does that answer notes, folks?
Yes, for Adam, when you write, what word processor do you use, and where do you keep these documents so that you can edit them wherever you want?
Ah, interesting. Good question. Keep in mind that as a professional writer who runs my own, I run my own systems. I write in a lot of different systems in a lot of different places. So, for instance, all Tidbits writing is done in BBEdit. And the reason for that is that BBEdit integrates with Subversion, which is our version control system, which integrates with the Tidbits publishing system, which is our content management system. So it's all a ball of wax, but it starts with BBEdit because of that's a good writing environment, and it fits with everything else. We also do a fair amount of writing in Google Docs. And we use Google Docs for take control marketing stuff, where Tonya and I have to work back and forth, and we do not want to have any delays or lags, and Google Docs is real time. So, you know, we can both be working in the same document at the same time. When we're running in Google Docs in that way, that information will end up being copied and pasted out to the take controls content management system or to HTML email that we're generating or something like that. So, in that case, the collaboration is really key, and so my writing will happen there. When I'm writing or editing for Take Control, and in terms of a book, it's all happening in Nicest Writer Pro. Nicest Writer Pro is an absolutely fabulous, powerful word processor that can do almost anything you can imagine because it has a full programming language built into it. And so along with having, you know, all the kinds of features of something like Word or Pages and more, you know, we've been able to build these macros, a lot of help from Joe Kissel on those, that will do exactly what we want. So that's essential for our book publication systems. So let's see. So there's those. We've just started using Slack. Actually, has this concept of a post now, which is just this like little itty bitty word processing environment where I can write and then I can share it with, say, Josh Centers, our managing editor, and say, Josh, could you edit this? And so we can go back and forth over just a paragraph or two, sometimes very quickly. And so that's nice. When you asked about how I can get to my stuff wherever I am, the answer is that I only ever get to this stuff on a Mac. And again, iOS, not a useful enough environment. It's too slow. It's too clumsy. I couldn't care less. And a lot of my systems are too serious. So for instance, Nicest Writer is way too powerful to work reasonably on iOS. And, you know, BBEdit, you could have text editors that would work on iOS certainly, but things don't tend to integrate very well with our version control system. So, you know, they don't support Subversion. And there may be something out there that does, but again, more trouble than it's worth. So I guess what I would say is that I use whatever tools I need to accomplish the task I need to accomplish. And if I need to do that on another machine, such as my MacBook Air, I will put the stuff in Google Docs or Google, or sorry, if it's in Google Docs, it's obviously accessible anywhere, but Google Drive or Dropbox. And we do a lot of that sort of stuff too, so that we can, you know, I mean, I can work on a file, Tonya can pick it up, bounce it back and forth, all of that kind of stuff. And again, keep in mind, there's even more than that. You know, I mean, I'll get stuff in Microsoft Word format. I'll work in InDesign, you know, all of that kind of stuff. Anything that can be written in, I will write in. And when the appropriate time and place comes about. I'm sorry.
A lot there.
Yeah. We're serious about this stuff. Yes, not getting it.
I need a translation.
So the question was, since you use paper and pencil, have you tried using Apple's pencil with the iPad Pro?
I would like to try that. We have not yet gotten an iPad Pro here at our house. So maybe we will at some point, and I will really like it. It will suffer a little bit from this sort of the storage question, but if it turns out that you can get the I feel that I'm getting kind of the handwriting benefit from that iPad Pro, then yeah, that could be really neat. Jeff Carlson, who works a lot with us, he got an iPad Pro and he has had said very nice things about it. So I guess that's a question for the future. Yeah.
Tonya, I'm curious, elaborate just for a second on what you mean by the handwriting advantage.
Well, there is research to support this, but I think it's true for me. When I write something with my hands, I think I learn it better. And the research that I've seen talks about how when you are typing to take notes, what people tend to do is literally transcribe the lecture because they can type fast enough to just pretty much type everything. Whereas when you use handwriting, you're more likely to be evaluating and analyzing what really needs to be written down. And for me, I will often, when there's time, I'll start even arranging it on the page as I write it to show what's more important and what's less important and how it's structured together. And I think that by going through that process, when I finish taking the notes, not only are my notes a better summary than, say, a transcript would be, but that I have internalized the information more deeply. So I'm not looking for a better typewriter or like a tape recorder or something. I'm not looking to come away with a transcript. Basically, I'm looking to come away with something that pulls out what was the most interesting to me or what I thought would be worth remembering. So if the iPad Pro can effectively replace a notebook, that would be very interesting. It is difficult for me. I'm in my late 40s, and I think probably for a lot of the people on this call to just cast aside everything that's old. I like the feeling of the paper and the notebook, so I'm not 100% sure if I would want to give it up, but it is my job to explore these digital technologies, and so I might give it a really good try and see where it got me.
Here's a recommendation for something to check out for people who do go to a lot of lectures, say, and wish to take notes. There's an app called PairNote. And pear is in the fruit. And PairNote can do three things, and I think this is actually pretty brilliant. One is it can record audio. Two, you can take photos, which is really useful if someone's putting up slides.
Yeah.
And then three, you can write handwritten notes. And it puts all this on a timeline so that you can, in essence, listen to the audio and then have, and sort of see where your notes fall on that timeline and see where the photos do. So in other words, you're getting sort of the best of all three modes. You know, you're listening to the person talking, you're seeing what they thought was important in their slides, and you're making your own notes. But by syncing them up, you don't have to go, oh, like, when did he talk about, why did I make that comment? Because that comment that you just wrote down is now in the context of what was being said at that moment in time. And as I love the concept of it, in reality, I don't go to enough lectures. I probably go to, three or four or five lectures a year at Cornell for various things. And I found that I never used the information so much as I enjoyed the ability to take notes and record lectures in this way. It wasn't actually something I was using them in any way. But it's a neat app. And it's on the Mac and the iPhone and the iPad.
Does it have syncing capability? As far as
I think so, although I'm not 100% sure.
Okay, just curious. Okay. Looking at the time, folks, I don't know how we stand for you all. I was going to suggest maybe one more question, if that's okay. Or
do we have any more questions? One last question.
Okay.
Okay. Do any of you author websites? And if so, what web authoring tool do you use?
Oh, boy.
Okay. So websites have changed a great deal. I mean, long ago, let's see here. I can pull it off of my shelf, I believe. Where is it? Yes, here we go. Tonya's book.
How very analog of you, Adam.
Create your own homepage. So back in the day, you made web pages and you would literally just create a page. In the modern world, when you're building a website, you basically do not do that anymore. There are good apps to still do that, but for a lot of systems, it's sort of not. It's just too much work. And so, for instance, I mentioned earlier that we have a content management system behind Tidbits. We also have a content management system behind Take Control. And we're setting up something new where I actually just set up WordPress, which is a blogging, sort of blogging software at the base level, but it's much more powerful than that as well. There are also services like Squarespace that make it very easy to build a small website with a couple of pages. And so what we do is for websites at this point is, for the most part, working in these content management systems. Every now and then I will do something where I'll be building HTML manually. And frankly, when I do that, I'm working in BBEdit. I'm working straight with the text. I'm not really interested in working with a web page authoring tool because I'm usually getting HTML from somewhere and putting it somewhere else. And it's not a, it just needs to be transferred and edited in between. So if I was going to recommend something to someone, I would say to check out Sandvox. That's a nice little tool. Let's see. Rapid Weaver, I think, is another one. I'm not sure if that's still being supported, but that's the other one that I would look at these days. I think Freeway is still being supported either. But those are sort of the three big ones for just building your own site with graphical tools, kind of in that iWeb mode.
Yeah, I've been a little using iWeb.
Yeah. Check out Sam.
I have so much invested. I would really love to find a tool that I could take that.
Lost audio. Lost everything.
Yep. So could you repeat that? We're sorry. We lost you there for a second.
Yeah, I have so much invested in iWeb. I'd like to take my HTML folder that I can export from my iWeb and import it into my authoring tool and proceed from there. And I can't do that with Sandbox or some of these other, what you see is what you get, tools.
Yeah,
well, that's disappointing. I've been thinking to myself, it's sort of odd that Apple hasn't updated iWeb, and I keep saying, well, but there are a lot of people who don't just want their online presence to be in Facebook or something, and they do have their own website, and I don't really see why Apple wouldn't make a tool for that.
Yeah, it's just not where Apple's at. I mean, Apple doesn't do publishing tools.
Well, that's true, but it took them something like 10 years, maybe not 10 years, 8 years to update their iWork apps, and they finally updated Pages and Keynote and Numbers.
Yeah. iWeb is
there. So, I don't know. I would still hold out hope. Maybe I'm just nostalgic.
No, don't hold out hope. Really, really. iWeb is totally dead.
Well, I've given up.
Sorry.
Yeah,
I don't know. I want something that I can take all of this work I've done and move it into another operating system.
Right.
I understand why.
Yeah.
Something else I was going to look for that someone else mentioned to me recently.
Yeah, I know who you're thinking about, Adam, and I can't think of it either right now. I've even had them on the show, which is really embarrassing.
Sparkle. Oh. It's something called Sparkles. I don't know if they have a solution for iWeb, but they supposedly do decent. I'll make sure Chuck has the URL. Sparklecafe.com. Just heard about them. They aim to completely replace hand coding for small and medium websites. So I don't know. Worth looking out for. But for something like transitioning, yeah, probably Sandvox, Rapid Weaver, Sparkle make the most sense because it's going to be similar to what you're used to. For anyone starting out new, I'd recommend something like Squarespace, because that's going to be really easy to get going on a new site.
And I can throw in, I've run the MacVoices sites on WordPress. Because I have, and I'm much like you, sir. I really dread the idea of trying to move everything over. I do have the MacVoices blog though on Squarespace. both platforms have some very distinct advantages. They're both great. They also have some distinct disadvantages. You know, nothing that I would recommend both of them. It's just be aware of the respective limitations. Adam, I'm right there with you. Rapid Weaver.
Yeah.
Rapid Weaver is, I think they're getting ready to come out with a new version. Sandbox is being maintained. So, I mean, the good news is there's a lot of good stuff out there. It's just a matter of, you know, you're going to either have to hire someone to do the translation, or you're going to have to block off a bunch of weekends to get it done. Sorry.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah. How we stand? Everything good?
Yep, we're in. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much for having us, folks. We really appreciate it. Happy 25th anniversary.
Yeah. It's great to see user groups going for so long.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Adam, again, for contributing to our raffle each month on the ebook.
Excellent. Glad
to
hear you.
That's great.
Yep. We'll see you right here again for 35. Is that okay? Adam, Tonya, great to see you both. Thanks so much.
You're very welcome.
Thank you. It's nice to see everybody.
Yep. And we'll be back with more from Mac Notables on Mac Voices. Thanks for watching. And again, happy 25th anniversary to SMOG. Visit MacVoices.com for links, show notes, to subscribe, to connect with Chuck on Twitter, Google+, YouTube, Facebook, LinkedIn, and the MacVoices blog. Subscribe to our weekly newsletter, the MacVoices Dispatch, to stay up to date on all the latest MacVoices news from our front page or at MacVoices.com/newsletter. Do more with your Apple tech by subscribing to the free MacVoices magazine on Flipboard by visiting macvoices.com/magazine. Advertising and sponsorships handled by Backbeat Media at backbeatmedia.com. Bandwidth provided by Cashfly at cashfly.com.